So if you look closely, you'll see that this image, it's a world map that's made out of apps. And there's actually a lot more apps than that in the world. And I want to talk today about how apps are affecting and changing the world in a revolutionary way. Because app stores, for the first time, eliminate the barrier between software makers and their audience. So with a click of the mouse, your app could be on the screen of a billion people. And I want to explain why this doesn't just mean a small advance for software, but something much more profound. It's an important evolutionary step in human culture. So, to use a metaphor familiar to Monterey residents, apps are filling every available software niche, from the cute, like Princess Camera, which makes every picture cute, to Cinemagram, which makes these beautiful, tiny animated movies, little movies you can share everywhere, to the grotesque, like Fat Booth, which takes any picture you take and makes it, you know, big. And then finally, of course, the frightening apps like 3D Zombifier, which turn anybody's face into a zombie. Because it's so successful, the app model of self-publishing is expanding to other media. This is an app called iBooks Author, and when you launch this app, you can make any book you want. This is a book called Why We Fight by a guy named Peter Pappas, who he published it himself about propaganda in World War II. So there are even apps to make books. And believe it or not, there are apps to make apps. And this is just one of them. It's an app, you use the app to create an app that's published in the App Store. Maybe, I don't know if you can make an app that creates apps itself in that app. If you have a Toyota, they've just released apps for their car, which is a little bit scary. but the app model is expanding to toys, to home appliances. So we're going way beyond the idea of a computer in every device to ecosystems that will eventually result in essentially the perfection of every single software task in every consumer device, everything we own and use. So some people are scared, especially big software companies. Microsoft, Adobe, they've done very little in the app stores because they'd have to share their profits with with Apple, with Amazon, and so on. And that 30% distribution fee to an independent developer is amazing to get on the screen of every mobile device in the world. And because these big companies are moving so slowly, it actually could mean the eventual demise of the biggest and most profitable companies in history. So app stores work really fast. This is an app I released right when the iPad came out, called Gravelux. Within 10 days, Eastern Europeans had cloned it and released an app called Gravitarium. And it was chasing me on the top 10. You know, it was right there on top 7. Then there was one called Gravelocity that came out another week later. Then there was one called Graviton. At first, I was actually a little bit upset. But then I realized actually my ratings were going up as those were, because people were commenting and saying, oh, this is just a ripoff of Gravelux. So, you know, like John F. Kennedy said, a rising tide lifts all boats. What happens to apps when they grow up? So their buyouts for mega hits. This is an app that came out a month ago called Mailbox. It just got sold for $50 million to Dropbox, which makes you wonder about their acquisition strategy, just anything with box at the end. this is called Draw Something, which is a really popular app, sold for $200 million to Zynga last year. Many of you know an app called Instagram, which sold to Facebook for $1 billion. Many apps don't have large enough markets to be acquired and consolidated. This app, Hipstamatic, is a modest app that only makes $10 million a year and remains independent. But below this level are probably hundreds of thousands now of individuals who have a kind of one-person companies that are almost like a new corner store in our economy, where they can make a comfortable living for themselves doing something they really love. So I played around with this a little bit. 3 years ago, I released three apps into the App Store, and they were an unanticipated success. The beautiful thing about them is that I myself couldn't explain what category they go into. I just put them in, entertainment. So this is an app called Gravelux. So what this app is, it's a kind of star drawing and animation program. You just move with your fingertips, and you can bring the stars towards you. What I was trying to do actually is give people some experience of nature. Like, actually, you know, we're really spoiled here in Monterey, but many people in the world have never seen a beach, a river, and so on. So these experiences are actually inspired by nature and meant to let people kind of interact with something like it under their fingertips. They also have a kind of side, kind of secret agenda, which is to increase concentration, long-term engagement. Somebody wrote as a review and said, oh, you know, I came home from work really angry today, and then I played with Gravelux for half an hour, and I felt quite good afterwards. So. Here's another one. None of these fit really into categories, but the beauty is they don't have to. This is an app called Bubble Harp. So it's a combination of a drawing program and a music program. You just touch the screen and it makes these diagrams that are kind of like spider webs or cells. And every single line creates a note based on its length. So it sounds quite good, right? You can make a song yourself by moving your fingers. Again, there's kind of a secret agenda here because you can change the scale. So this is a chromatic scale, which makes something sound a little more sophisticated, like modern music, maybe better than some modern music. The Hungarian minor scale sounds kind of exotic to Western ears. So secretly, you're actually learning something by using these apps, but I hate to use the words learning or education because right now they've kind of become synonyms for boring. This is actually my personal favorite app called Antigraph. This is an ant drawing program. So you just move your fingertips, you draw with ants. In many ways, it's kind of a parody of a computer program, you know. You can write, you can draw with it, TEDx. But the ants sort of disappear. Again, it's kind of a parody of a program, like what are these controls, you know, make it bigger, smaller, ant. <you know. laughs> But I'll tell you guys, this is funny, but I actually made enough money off of these to start a whole other company doing this called Snibbe Studio, not at the $10 million level, but at a level where I could hire employees and keep growing. These apps in total have sold over like 700,000 copies. And they led to some bigger things. I got one of these kind of life-changing emails from Bjork a couple years ago, and she said, "Ooh, I'm working on a project. I want to make the world's first app album as a kind of mashup of education and music." So this is her app, which is, we're just really, really pleased to have a chance to work with her and the other developers who made this app. At the beginning of the app, you go into this world that is the album cover. You know, the album died. You can't really buy albums very easily anymore, and few people do. But this is a new way of imagining an album as this interesting combination of music and education. So Bjork, for this project, she wanted to take on a new subject matter. Her first six albums were about herself through kind of personas, emotional experiences. She wanted a new topic for a seventh album. The topic she chose was the entire universe. So when you move into the app, there's a few side dishes and then a main dish. One of the things you can do in these apps is look at the structure of music in a kind of non-Western notation. So this is a way of looking at this song called Virus, which is about, it's kind of a love song between viruses and a cell, that viruses love a cell so much that they have to kill it. But you see how easily it's almost like a player piano. You can actually understand musical structure far better with this kind of interface. And you can drag and scroll. And it's completely interactive. Everything's very highly, fully interactive, not just a movie. The main event in each song is some kind of unique interactive experience. So with Virus, it's a kind of interactive music video. Everything in here is somewhere along the spectrum from musical instrument to music video, but with interactivity added. So in this one, you have a fully interactive world. You can drag cells around by their nucleus. Bjork wanted things to be really like National Geographic, kind of highly scientifically accurate. I mean, I know you can't drag cells around by their nucleus, but mostly accurate. Viruses have been enlarged, so you can see them. And the viruses come in, and they start to attack this cell. and you can fling the viruses away. It kind of seems like a game that you want to win by protecting the cell. And the cells around the edges also sing along at the chorus. But the app actually does teach you how viruses infect a cell. Over the course of the song, you see the viruses crack open and they inject DNA into the cell. The DNA goes to the nucleus and starts replicating. So the song actually does teach you how viruses work. The other thing is that if you do choose to protect this cell, then the song gets into a kind of holding pattern two verses in. So this is a game that you have to lose in order to hear the whole song. You have to let the cell get infected and die in order to hear the whole song. You know, nature's, as we heard in the other talk, you know, nature is violent, especially in Iceland. So you can check this out yourself if you have time later and see the whole experience. I'll show you just one other one. That was obviously about viruses. Thunderbolt is about electricity. So in this app, you can touch and create kind of light little taps of electricity. You can also draw with lightning, so you get the sound of lightning. But the main event here is to put two fingers down and you get an arpeggio. So that's one note. And as you stretch your fingers apart, you get two notes, three notes, four notes, five notes. So you start to learn about arpeggios. But I mean, anybody who's studied music formally, it is a bit tiring and uninspiring learning a lot of this stuff. So how about learning it with lightning? So as you move your fingers up, you can increase the tempo, decrease the tempo, put multiple fingers down so that you get kind of your own arpeggios, you make your own note sequence. So what is this app? What category does it go into? Okay, it's in the music category, but it's really this mashup of education, the universe, and interactive music theory. It's another category-defying product that sold an enormous amount of copies, and it never could have existed without this app ecosystem. How would you even release such a product, 4 years ago? So the question I think you want to start thinking about is, what happens to all these traditional markets in this completely open, wild marketplace? Is this the form that education ultimately starts to take in a marketplace? Is it artists that create music and art around topics that they love? Does that become the new textbook? We're moving a bit beyond software inevitability. I think it's pretty obvious with biophilia. That wasn't an inevitable product. It's not like someone else was going to make something like Bjork's creation. But program like Photoshop was. This is the 1988 first version of Photoshop. Editing photos, it was an inevitable app. VisiCalc and then what became Excel, something to edit spreadsheets and do finance, an inevitable app. But an app like Instagram, I mean, who would have known an app to share square photographs would become, $1 billion, $100 million user phenomenon. Not inevitable. This is an app a few people know about called ViClone. I'm a big fan of this new app, where everybody in the room who has this app can shoot a video from a different point of view, and it combines all the videos automatically into an edited. So if you're at a concert, someone can be backstage, you can be back there, and all of a sudden you have a movie at the end from every single point of view, cut together automatically. Not inevitable. This app called Songify, this is an app where you take this app, you just say anything into it, and it adds a tune to everything you say and turns it into a song. Massively popular app, definitely not inevitable. So all of these kind of things can snowball, creating completely anticipated categories of human experience and changing the way that people spend their time. This is an app that I'm a big fan of, too, by one of the people that worked on the Bjork app. This is called The Elements. This has been the best-selling book app in the App Store for 3 years running. So who would have thought that an app about copper, iron, sulfur would somehow be the best-selling app? But it's because the people that developed this app realized that the universe is interesting. It's not a multiple choice test with one right answer. So we're in a radically new era where anyone can have a great interactive idea and things that aren't as easily labeled as art, science, or education and bring them directly to market. This is the definition of a term people use often today called disruptive. Again, what happens? Is it the destruction of the textbook market? The collapse of our entire education system? Now teachers have to start competing with every inventive mind on the planet. Artists, scientists, hobbyists, and I think that's a great thing. So there's something quite intimate happening with apps because they're now carried along with our bodies. Today our bodies have become connected to computers, and there's great rewards and also great pitfalls to this kind of intimate relationship depending on what path we choose to take. So part of my fear is that we keep moving towards more distraction, more attachment, more jumping between email, Angry Birds, and New York Times in this kind of frenzy of consumption. See, you know what I'm talking about. This frenzy of consumption where you just want the next thing, right? As soon as you're on one thing, you think about the next, and the phone makes it really easy to switch. This is the next step, Google goggles, beaming information right into their eyes. And someone asked me recently to think of a beneficial use of this technology, and I was really struggling for a while. Because this technology takes you straight away from the person who you're standing in front of, even if you're looking her right in the eye. But then I recalled certain meditations you do to increase compassion. I'm actually a kind of amateur Buddhist. One of the things, there's professionals, you know, like the Dalai Lama, the professional Buddhist. So really, if you want to learn about Buddhism, try professional. But one of these meditations is to imagine the heroic arc of everyone's life as you encounter them every day. That every single person you see was once born, and their mom went through a lot of effort to make that happen. And also, every single person is going to die, surrounded by their friends or all by themselves. If you can remember that every time you run into someone, you tend to have a bit more kind of open, strong connection with that person. So what if your Google goggle overlaid that as you're looking at somebody? What if I saw, your cute little baby pictures, or maybe even you being born, or pictures with your kids? Or what if it showed your life expectancy, the date you were projected to die? That would really remind you of life's context and help you be engaged in the moment. So there's another step beyond Google goggles, for better or for worse. And there's something Jonathan Harris, who's someone I really admire, great developer and activist, he says these attaching computers to our bodies are a rehearsal for the day when computers are going to be directly connected to our minds. So there's a researcher at Berkeley called Jack Gallant. He's created technology that literally reads people's minds. The top row there are video clips that he presented to people. And he created a computer system that tries to look on YouTube and blend together all the videos on YouTube to reconstruct the video. So go check this out when you have a moment and watch the videos. You've got, I don't know why he chose the Inspector Clouseau remake, but you see that, reconstructed on the bottom, elephants and so on. Any of you know Gerhard Richter, the painter? They actually look a lot like Gerhard Richter paintings. And so maybe actually, it made me think, maybe what artists do with their art is actually truer to our inner reality than a literal rendition. So what if we start now and start using this kind of technology to figure out how to create, say, inner peace, or maybe even world peace, by analyzing the minds of meditators like Matthew Richard, who's one of the great living monks. Luckily, people are already doing this. This is from a study by Richie Davidson at the University of Wisconsin-Madison in 2008 to figure out how our brains are positively changed by meditation. Now, what does that app look like? So this is a little, like I said, meditation, Buddhism is my hobby. So this is something we did with the Vajrapani Institute, a meditation retreat center in Boulder Creek. We just did our first online meditation course. And it was extremely exciting because people now didn't have to go to this remote location to do meditation. Now the results are unbelievable from this. We had 43 out of 53 students actively participated. The average time meditating per day per person was 26 minutes. Just very, very, try sitting still just for 2 minutes and meditate later today and see how hard it is. And most people meditated 4 out of 7 days. So, of course, we're not the only people doing this. There's a lot more people out there with the same goal, and you can already get these apps in the App Store. This is the happiness app. This is an app that will kind of track how happy you are and helps you to become a little bit happier. This is an app called Headspace, which is giving people more structured training in meditation, more of a kind of scientific approach to meditation, not rooted in any kind of religious tradition, just to help you like sleep better, have more concentration, and so on. This is an app called Lyft that I really like. It's a social network for good habits. So you can choose any habit you like exercise, floss, talk to a stranger, and you just check into it, and then other people can say, yay, that's great that you did this today. But it really works. It really works. These are all apps that increase positive human qualities, concentration, contentment, satisfaction, and things like that. So each of us could be contributing to projects like this too, right? We're in a very sensitive time. Any of you who are involved in, you know, creating stuff of any sort, I think we have maybe a 2 to 5 year window where we're in a space that's still very sensitive to initial conditions. And literally, I think right now, anything is possible. It's very possible to change the course of human cultural evolution by the right kind of app. So a single software future isn't inevitable. And like the chaotic system, you know, the famous flapping butterfly wings, it's sensitive to the initial early conditions. So these small apps that are created today, or that some of us could cause to be created, may determine how we spend much of our time in the future, how we treat others, or even how we think. So I really want to encourage people, if you can make stuff like this, to go out and try to make it. But if not, think about spending a little bit of your time today, so easy to download these kind of apps, and spend a tiny bit of your day using apps that move the human mind a little bit towards a more positive human qualities. Thank you. Thank you.